Hello everyone and welcome back to Rick's Garage. Today I try to get the new bike up and running, and we cover a checklist that could potentially save you a world of headache with your own barn find. Say hello to the bad side. My emotion is flatline. Hungry demon, what I'm seeing is snack time. When I rush in the grab, I better run from the path line. For a tinkerer, there's nothing better than getting a new toy to play with. As soon as I had Project Quarantina in the garage, the first thing I wanted to do was start cranking on the ignition and hear the engine fire. If you're anything like me, your excitement can easily cause you some problems. When you get your hands on an engine with an unknown history, there's a few important things that need to be checked before you can safely turn the key. Obviously, there are certain things that will apply specifically to this bike, but the overall method that I use can be applied to any bike, car, or really anything with an engine. After verifying that the engine will actually turn, it's important to dump the oil before doing anything else. That is, of course, assuming that the motor has oil in it. That'll give you the first indication on the engine's condition. I also like to run a strong magnet, like this one, through the old oil and see if it picks anything up. A bunch of metal in the oil could mean big problems and a quick end to the project. With the magnet coming out clean, the engine gets filled back up with fresh oil. It's also a good idea to remove the spark plugs and pour some oil in each cylinder. This will prevent unnecessary damage from the dry piston rings scratching against the cylinder walls. I also popped the valve cover and poured some oil on the top end components. Much like the pistons, these parts haven't moved in a while, and engines do not like metal on metal contact. Once I was confident that the engine wouldn't be turning dry, out came the compression tester. A compression tester is a gauge with a one-way valve, not unlike the blood pressure meter at your doctor's office or pharmacy. The hose is threaded into the spark plug hole, and when the engine is turned, it'll measure the maximum compression force, measured in PSI or kilopascals, applied to the air inside the cylinder. A quick compression test will give you an overview on how the engine's doing. If an engine has low or no compression on one or more cylinders, you've got yourself an internal problem and there's no point going any farther trying to start it. Although Quarantina's compression was on the lower end, it came up pretty even across all cylinders, which tells me a couple of good things. First, the piston rings and valve seats are in good enough shape to seal the cylinder, and the valve timing is in reasonable shape. If either was way out of whack, the cylinders wouldn't be able to generate any compression. Now, every gas-powered engine needs three basic things to run: air, spark, and fuel. If you haven't checked that your motor's getting all three, it'll be a big guessing game if you have a no-start situation. Air is the easiest, and it's already done because the bike has no intake box and no air filter to speak of. All that'll come later. Next is the electrical. It can be the trickiest to figure out, and the previous owner didn't make it any easier because the wiring harness is a mess. The poor thing has had almost every plastic connector cut off and discarded. So, armed with the factory wiring diagram and some butt connectors, I spent the next few hours sorting out what goes where and what needs power to fire the engine. After temporarily connecting main power, I moved to the points assembly, which is what tells the ignition coils when to fire. While inspecting them, I found that a botched install created a big problem. The governor wheel with all the timing marks is normally locked in position on the crankshaft with the help of a hardened steel guide pin. Somebody in the bike's history with ham hands put the wheel on without aligning it to that pin first, and when it was tightened, it sank the pin flush with the face of the crank, allowing the wheel to spin independently. It took a bit to decide how to fix the problem, but hey, the name in the intro isn't Rick the Machinist, so I got to work. After a bit of creative TIG welding, the ignition timing system was back together and set according to the factory service manual. The steps of setting the timing I'll save for a separate video. Once the timing is set and the coils know when to fire, a multimeter verifies that the coils are good and should work. New plugs are gapped and the leads are replaced to make sure the fuel ignites from a nice strong spark. After purchasing a new battery, each plug is grounded to the engine and spark is visually confirmed. With the electrical sorted, it's time to move on to the fuel system. Oh, and once I was able to roll the engine with the electric starter, I rechecked the compression and I was much happier with the results. Much like everything in our daily lives, the gasoline in your fuel system has a best before date. While exposed to air, those premium unleaded dinosaurs can start turning sour in as little as 30 days if unused. In extreme cases, gas can actually degrade to a shellac that will not only gum everything up, it'll cause you nothing but frustrations trying to diagnose a no-start. So, depending on the amount of time that your project's been sitting, be prepared to remove all the fuel system components, at the very least to clean them out. When Quarantina was dropped off, Frank had mentioned that the gas tank had a failed coating. Now, it's very common for these old tanks to have a DIY epoxy liner, and this is no exception. Unfortunately, even when you do all the prep work right, sometimes the coating just doesn't last. Now, obviously, all this junk has got to get cleaned out, otherwise it's going to cause nothing but problems later on. After filling the tank with acetone and leaving it sit for a few days, I was actually able to get a lot of the old coating out. Probably enough for a test fire, maybe a little bit of idle time, but I think the tank still may need to be sent out to be professionally cleaned before put back into regular service. The good news is that most radiator shops can do a caustic dip that will chemically strip everything off the inside of the tank. The bad news is that it'll strip everything off the outside too. Now obviously it's no issue for this one, but it's not the right solution if you're not planning on repainting later. Beyond providing a word for immature welders to snicker at, a petcock serves one of the simplest yet most important jobs. It's the main shutoff valve for the fuel tank. Unfortunately for these units, they are definitely showing their age. One was completely frozen and the extra sealant on the screws and main gasket are telltale signs of leaks. Once I had one open, I found that the internal soft parts, well, aren't so soft anymore. So the easiest solution was to order some rebuild kits from eBay. After disassembly, it was into the ultrasonic cleaner with some Simple Green solution to get all the gunk out. Out of the bath, the petcocks get a new gasket set and vacuum diaphragm, and they're ready for service. The carbs were off the bike when I got it, so although I was hoping they were stored well, all the spider webs told a different story. Surprisingly, despite their outward appearance, the internals actually didn't look too bad. I could have buttoned them back up, thrown them back on, and they probably would have worked, but since I was already on eBay, I decided to order some rebuild kits just to be safe. A leaky fuel system is nothing to take lightly.
And the flames went higher, and it burns, burns, burns.
I'll be doing a separate video on how I rebuilt the carbs, but once they were reassembled, they were installed on the engine with some new rubber boots, and the fuel system is done. All right, now that we've verified that Quarantina's engine is safe to turn, we've made sure that it's going to get air, spark, and fuel, let's give the ignition a go and see if we can't bring her back to life. After cranking on the ignition for what felt like forever, Quarantina did not want to play ball. I was getting a little discouraged until suddenly... got here is a running bike. All right, I'm putting a successful ignition in the win category for this project. After a bit of adjustment, Quarantina can now stay running on her own, but there's still a boatload of work to be done before we can call her a motorcycle again. If you've enjoyed watching her resurrection, leave a like and a comment, and if you'd like to see more of Project Quarantina, be sure to subscribe for instant notifications as soon as a new video is ready, and as always, thanks very much for watching.